So I hope everybody has enjoyed that song. We sang this a couple of times in SSMC already, Jesus Christ by Living Hope by Phil Wickham. So I will title today's sharing on my living hope. As I mentioned earlier that we started this week's study on hope, I think the Christianity hope, okay, is very much different from what I would say the non-Christian look at it. And it's such a big topics, that's why we need to spend 6 days, if you read from Monday to Saturday. Okay, we have to spend about 6 days just to look into hope. And as I was preparing, I was telling my wife, well, this is such a hard topic for me to prepare because I'm going to sharing with a lot of seasoned and mature person and telling them about hope. And it should be the reverse, you know, Henry Wong should be telling me there is hope in life. But then, as I look at it, interestingly is today's is talking about, if you look at the food for the day, for a Christian, hope is Christ. Reflect on it. It's a very, very, I would say, powerful phrase there. For a Christian, hope is Christ. And reflect on it. So as usual, I will start it with something very light. I mean, we're very, very familiar with this English sentence, fingers crossed, okay? Fingers crossed, I'll see you. Fingers crossed, hopefully everything will be fine. And fingers crossed, you know, it is to hope strongly that something will happen. And it is directly taken out from the Cambridge Dictionary. An example there is, we are keeping our fingers crossed that he'll be healthy again very soon. So this is how the world look at fingers crossed. Basically, is hoping. In case something good will happen. So I managed to find a video, just watch it and then let it be educational, okay? What does fingers cross? Or basically what does the world, okay, look at hope?
We cross our fingers for luck. We've been doing it for centuries, but why? Originally, the gesture needed two people. It was an ancient pagan custom for people to cross fingers with each other. They believed their wishes would be kept safe at the point where their fingers crossed, until they came true. This idea of capturing good fortune also explains the practice of tying string around a finger. For Celts and Anglo-Saxons, it would literally tether good luck to a person. The gesture also has roots within Christianity. When faced with persecution, early Christians would cross their fingers to invoke the power of Christ's crucifixion. And in a secret handshake, they would cross fingers with fellow Christians before gathering together in safety for Mass. The handshake made the Christian symbol of the ichthys, or sign of the fish. It's thought that Christians who were persecuted would cross their fingers to absolve themselves from the lies they told to their tormentors. And that is why we cross our fingers behind our back when making a promise we don't intend to keep. In England, in the 16th century, people crossed their fingers to protect themselves from evil coughs and sneezes. In a 1787 book of popular superstitions, it recommended keeping your fingers crossed after walking under a ladder, until you see a dog. But it is the gesture's association with good luck that has stood the test of time. A recent University College of London study found that crossing fingers confuses the way our brains process pain signals, actually reducing painful sensations. And if that's true, then that would be a bit of good luck for everyone.
Okay, so I hope you enjoyed the video. It's a bit of like it's fun and educational. So I'm not sure about the early Christians part. Should a Christian cross their fingers? I think there's another school of debate. Okay, but put it this way, why I want to bring out this video is in a sense, like I said, let everybody know that how the world look at good luck, which is in a sense tied to hope. Okay, hopefully this will happen. So something to do with luck. But then when we look at hope, when we look at one's life, okay, this is what we call Abraham Maslow hierarchy of needs. Because as a person, in a sense, grow, or in a, as a person matured in life, Abraham Maslow, okay, he has this pyramid, which is what we talk about needs. Every person, we hope something for our physiological needs, which is food, water. We hope for safety needs, security, job. We hope for love, belonging. We hope for self-esteem. So it usually is status recognitions. And the last is talk about self-actualizations, meaning that you want to be good in something. You want to be good in providing safety. You want to be good in respect. So this is how he analyzed, in a sense, as a person, these are the things that we hope for in our life. So it is quite true, because even as I look at myself, you know, even as a Christian, what are we hoping for? And most of the time we are looking at worldly things, which is generally our wealth, our health, companion. We hope for our families, our children, their educations, their future career. And last few days, I think this is everybody's hope that the spike, you know, will be, the number will reduce, but I think our hope has been dashed. You know, every day you're looking at 300, 400, 500, okay? And we have high hope for, you know, in the political arena, we have hope for our next gen, we have hope for society, our country, and of course, being missional like SSMC, which everybody is belonging to, we have hope for the church at large. So these are the kind of hope, you know, that, I mean, practically, this is what is in our mind all the time. But today, I just want to look at one thing which is very simple, which is the hope that lasts. Okay, as I say, hope is a very, very wide topic. Okay, and today's basically it has summarized, okay, the Christian hope from the death of Christ, from the resurrections of Christ, from the transformations, you know, until we see Jesus again. This is the gist of Christian hope. Above all things, okay, if you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13, there are three things that will last forever: faith, hope, and love. And of course, we know that love is the so-called greatest of all. But somebody interpreted faith, it is our foundation in Jesus. Hope is our attitude and our focus. And love is our actions. So these three things, they go hand in hand. They cannot be independent. So that's why hope, it is also part and parcels, okay, of what we call the so-called Christian characters. And today's reading in Romans chapter 8, verse 24 to 25. And we were told, we were given this hope when we were saved. When we received Jesus, we were given this hope. And what is this hope? Is freedom from death and decay, release from sin and suffering, new body, full sonship. This is all in Romans chapter 8. And we were told again, we need to wait patiently and confidently. Okay. And in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19, and we were again reminded that we are secured and we are unmovable and anchored in hope. This is the hope that lasts. And I hope this is not something which, you know, it is like very far-fetched. Because when we look at our life, when we reflect in our life, when we look at the things that have gone past, when we look at the thing that is facing us, I believe this hope, okay, that is so secure and unmovable anchor in God should be able to encourage us to face any, in a sense, storms in our life. And what I really like, you know, again, a reminder for us that one day, you know, we will have the full sonship together with God. And this is the hope, the Christian hope that lasts eternity. And there's only two Bible verses I just want to bring up and then just share. Okay, in a sense, it is God's promise as we laid our hope, as we look towards Jesus to return, when we are still on this earth. These are the two Bible verses, okay, I want to share when we talk about the topics of hope. They are very familiar. First one is, people always quote that, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know my plan for you. It's a plan for good and not for disaster. It gives you a future and a hope. I'll go into that in detail later on. And the next one is in Romans chapter 12, verse 12. Rejoice in our confident hope. Be patient in trouble. Some versions say in tribulation. And keep on praying. And why do I just want to bring out these two verses? Because I want to tie into what we are facing today. Okay? What are we facing today is really the pandemic has opened our eyes. The COVID-19 has stopped everything in this world. Okay, if I just read the news, you know, even cruise liners are being dismantled. Even airlines are being, you know, they have been forced to shut down. But as Christ believer, our hope is still anchored in God. And let's look into detail again. What does God promise just based on these two verses? The first one from Jeremiah 29. Most of you who have studied this before, but I just refresh your memory again. The background is, okay, the letter is written by Jeremiah and sent to the exile in Babylon. Okay, Jeremiah 21 verse 1. And those who were exiled, they have been, in a sense, influenced by false teachers, false prophets. That they promised, say, don't worry, you know, we will return to Jerusalem very soon. But then Jeremiah received the word of God and told them the instruction from God is, life do not grind to a halt in unpleasant time. See, this is the hope that we have. When God said that, even though you are in unpleasant time, but please continue your life. Seek peace, be a blessing, and pray for it. Okay, read that in Jeremiah 29. Seek peace, be a blessing. Be a blessing to the community. Pray for it. Why? Because that is God's promise. The hope that God has given to the exile. The promise that God said himself, that he will visit them. He will visit them. And he will bring them home. And the most powerful is here. God's plan or God's thought towards them. Can you imagine God's thought and plan is towards us? And you read in Psalms 40 verse 5. Many, Lord my God, are the wonders you have. Are the wonders you have done. The things you have planned for us. And lastly, God's promise is God will listen if one looks for him wholeheartedly. So imagine we are like the exile. Okay, we are in a place which is far away. But this is the hope that we receive through the letter. So when I look at the pandemic today, you know, it's in the sense that we are, I can say we are literally also captives. Why are we called captives? Because we are being, in a sense, put into fear. The fear has gripped us. In a sense, we are all captives. Okay. But the promise that the God made is he will visit us. He will bring us home. Okay. Things may not be back to normal, but it will be, you know, in a place that is safe for us. And God always has a good plan towards us. Okay? and he will listen if we look for him wholeheartedly. I believe this is a very good reminder to all of us when we talk about the topics of hope. You know, that as I say many times, the current pandemic, you know, in a sense has dashed many people's hope. But when we look at God's point of view, when we look at where God is today and his promise, okay, will always come true. So let it be a reminder and encouragement to all of us that when we seek God wholeheartedly, okay, he will make sure that his plan will not harm all of us. Okay, so this is the first one that I just want to share. The second one is from Romans chapter 12, verse 12. Some call it that is instruction, okay, on Christian living or Christian characters by Paul. But I like what John Piper said here. Just be happy in hope, patient in pain, okay, and constant in prayer. I think this is very straightforward and very simple to understand. When we are in the midst of hopelessness, Romans chapter 12, verse 12 is reminding us over and over again, be happy in our hope. Be confidently rejoicing in the hope, but not rejoicing in the result. See, most of the time, myself included, we hope for the result. As I said earlier, that we hope for education for our children, we hope for our country, because that is what we are looking at, the end result. But Paul is reminding the Romans, just rejoice because you have hope. Okay? Rejoice because you have hope. And it is in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18, I put there again. I pray that your heart will be flooded with light, so that you can understand the confident hope he has given to those who called. Okay, be confident in the hope that we have. And this hope, okay, as we learned and studied many times, is of course, is also based upon the faith, which we talk about many times in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. So it's a reminder to us over and over again that we have to confidently rejoice in our hope. Okay, but of course, it's easier to say than done. Most of the time, I myself included, I just want to hope in the end result. But I forget about the hope that has been already given to us because God has called us. And the second point Paul pointed out is be patient in trouble. And this is not about just enduring or forbearing. When you talk about patient in pain, okay, Paul is reminding us again, continue to do God's work while we have hope in Jesus. Patient, yes, but just continue to do God's work. Just like what was reminded by Jeremiah to those exiled, be a blessing. Though you are in exile, be a blessing. And third, which we are all very, very familiar with, is steadfast in prayer. So these are the three key characters, in a sense. I won't say it is a very legalistic way, but this hope, patient, and steadfast, in a sense, it will mold us as Christian characters when we talk about, you know, Christian living. But having said that, Paul reminded the Romans again in verse 9 of Romans chapter 12. Even when we do all these things, do this for genuine love. Even when we have hope, even when we have the hope, you know, for God to come and intervene in the current pandemic, even we have hope that God will see us through, even we have hope, you know, for our frontliners, but let our hope be built on love, as God has reminded us through Romans chapter 12, verse 9. Lastly, I just want to again allude back to the song, Our Living Hope. And I was so pleased yesterday during the, you know, testimony sharing. This verse is again you know, mentioned by our sisters. Lamentation chapter 3, verse 21 to 23. Yet, I think Pastor Komoy emphasized this word, yet I still dare to hope. I still dare to hope. I still dare to hope that when the numbers, you know, of COVID-19 infection is spiking every day, yet I still dare to hope that the faithful love of God will never end and His mercy never cease. Great is His faithfulness and His mercies begins afresh each morning. I believe this verse is also very, very relevant today. Every day when we read, in a sense, bad or sad news, you know, whether from the internet, from the newspaper, but every day when we wake up, yet we still dare to hope because God is at His throne and He has given us this confident hope that we can rejoice in. And I want to end by paraphrasing Ephesians chapter 12, verse 12. Okay, paraphrase, huh? Don't say that I misquoted the Bible. Okay, being with Jesus, meaning not separated from Jesus, that we will have hope and God in this world. I believe this is the living hope that we cling on to, not separated from Jesus, and we will have hope and God in this world.